happening, the awakening, so come,
yeah.
Holy Spirit.
Well, good morning, Northside. So good to see you here this Easter morning. Happy Easter to everybody. Awesome. Will you turn to your neighbor and will you say, "He is risen, risen indeed." All right. There you go. Awesome, awesome, awesome. So we have a new song we're going to do for you this morning that ties directly into the resurrection. And I'm going to have Miss Hope Adigan introduce it to you.
Thank you, Mike. I think any day, we can all agree, church, that any day that we know that the sacrifice that our Savior made for us on the cross is a good day because we get to have new life through Him. I want you guys to stand to your feet. We're going to teach you a new song. We're going to have some fun this Easter morning.
Run for cover, but the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have a resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over. My name testimony from death to life, 'cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous.
Well, happy Easter, everyone. You can be seated. We are so glad you are joining us today. My name is Chris. I'm one of the pastors here on staff. And today, we get to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ, right? Man, if this is your first time here, I would just like to say welcome. We're so glad you're joining us today. We would love to meet you. If after the service you stop by the lobby at our Welcome Center, we would love to give you a little gift and hear a little bit about your story and know who you are. We're so glad that you're joining us and worshiping our Savior today. So what an awesome day, right? Let me pray for you right now. God, we are so thankful that there is an empty tomb and you are a risen Savior. We are so thankful that you have pursued our hearts, that you desire to have a relationship with us, Lord. We pray for today, for those that have joined us. God, we ask that you make yourself known to each and every person here. Lord, we are so grateful for the time that we get to worship you. God, we pray for those that are here that are hurting, that are sick, that need a touch from you. Lord, we pray today that you make yourself known to them. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we have something exciting about to happen this week, and we are celebrating 7 baptisms. We have 3 during this service. We have 3 during this service, and baptism is a way that we identify with our Savior in his death and resurrection, right? So it's a way that we say, we have a relationship with Jesus, and I want you guys to know it. I want to make it public that I am being baptized, that I have a relationship with Jesus, and we identify with our Christ to do that. And no better day to celebrate that than Easter, right? So turn your attention to the baptismal.
Well, good morning, guys. What a testimony it is to have a baptism. It's awesome, and we just sung that today, a testimony. And I want you to welcome Ashley Thompson to the baptismal. Perfect. So I got to meet with Ashley a couple of weeks ago, and I don't think she'll mind me sharing, but she said she's been going through a lot of struggles and a lot of dark spots in her life. And we shared the gospel together, and she just claimed the name of Jesus right there and just took him as Lord. And I just want to say I'm so excited for you.
I am too.
And I'm excited to see you here now, just publicly declaring to your family and your church family your faith.
Yes.
So just a couple of questions. Is it true that you've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior?
I have.
Good. Is it your desire to follow him in believer's baptism?
It is.
Ashley, my sister in Christ, by your profession of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Very nice to love kisses. Raise them up in the name of the Lord. Morning, church. What a joy to be together. So happy for Ashley. That was awesome. Would you also welcome this morning Kathy Goodspeed? As we've talked about, there's nothing in these waters that wash away our sin. This is our way of letting everybody know we believe Christ died for us, was buried, and rose again. So grateful this week for the opportunity to hear your faith journey. And I think you've been looking forward to this moment to just come to the place of declaring your faith. Kathy, do you come today to confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord of your life and your Savior?
I have.
And are you coming today to request baptism in obedience to his command as a follower of Christ?
Yes, I do.
Awesome. Based upon your profession of faith in Jesus, your desire to follow him, I baptize you, my sister in Christ, Kathy Goodspeed, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Amen.
also welcome this morning Chet Thompson as he comes to declare his faith. As I recall, as we met this week, you told me that you started coming here somewhere around 2016, something like that. It's kind of been a journey, but one of those Sundays, you just surrendered your life to Christ. You told me about that day, and I'm excited for you to walk with Jesus. All right. Are you coming today to confess that Jesus Christ is your Lord? You've surrendered your life to Him.
Yes.
Are you also coming today to be baptized in obedience to His command as a follower of Christ?
Amen.
Amen. Based upon your profession of faith in Jesus and your desire to follow Him, I baptize you, my brother in Jesus, Chet Thompson, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of His death, raised in the likeness of His resurrection.
Oh, isn't that awesome to see, church? It's a representation of Christ rising from the dead. Amen. Stand with us as we continue to worship.
You bought my freedom. The great I am, a crown of thorns upon his head. The Father's heart displayed for us. Oh God, we thank you for the cross. And lifted up on Calvary's hill, we curse your name, and even still, you bore our shame and paid the cost. Oh God, we thank you for the cross. Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hands. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. We sing your praise, endless hallelujahs to your holy name. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. And offer sacrifice for every sin. Our Savior died, the Lord of life. He can't be contained. Our God has risen from.
Church, like I did, if you've been part of a church for a long time, you're all going to know it. I want you to sing it with me. God sent his son. They called him Jesus.
He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives.
All together now.
Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone.
Father, in right here in this moment, Lord God, life is worth living. Why? Because You live, and we thank You, Father, for it. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You may be seated, church.
Hey, my name is Hope.
My name is Brian.
My name is Danielle.
John.
Lynette. And I used to be lost.
At one point,
I was constantly
hopeless.
No one was able to help.
I looked everywhere.
I couldn't find real answers.
I struggled with finding my purpose.
I struggled with rage and anger.
I struggled with how people would view me.
With my mental health and self-harm. With control. And then I met Jesus.
I met Jesus.
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 Then I met Jesus. Jesus gave me hope.
Finally felt true love because Jesus died for me.
Because Jesus died for me. Died for me. Jesus
died for me.
I have true life.
I have true life.
I have true life.
Jesus gave me hope.
And because Jesus rose from the dead,
I have a relationship with Him now.
Relationship.
A relationship.
Relationship. I have a relationship with Him now.
Good morning. He's risen. Yes. Let's try that again. The response is, He's risen indeed. Okay? Ready? He's risen.
He's risen.
Yes. It's like you guys trying to clap on that first song. It's kind of comical. Yeah. Oh, what a great morning. Let's go to the scriptures, John 20. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going towards the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen clothes lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen clothes lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen clothes, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and he believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. Bow your heads with me. Lord, we come before you as your people. And we just thank you right now. We thank you that because you came to earth, became one of us, lived perfectly so that our failures could be put on you on the cross and your righteousness could be given to us. And because you died, we can have life with you. And because you rose and there's an empty tomb, we could have hope that on that day we will be with you in paradise. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Dr. Habermas shared a personal story of how the resurrection of Jesus got him through the most painful experience in his own life. I'll never forget the day after Easter when I received the shocking news from my doctor. Your wife has stomach cancer. That's arguably the worst kind of cancer you can get. Weeks later, I sat on my porch as Debbie was sleeping. She had a tube coming out of her stomach, and I had to feed her through the tube 3 times a day. As Debbie slept, I sat on the porch and had my conversation with God, similar to that of Job in the Old Testament. I prayed, "Come on, God. She's only 43. And she's up there dying. Lord, she's the mother of my children. She's my closest friend. Let her live." Dr. Habermas did not get a quick response, but later he felt God's comfort. It was as if he said, "Gary, I understand you're hurt. I know your pain. Gary, I watched my son die. I saw every whiplash. I watched him asphyxiate. Do you expect better than my son received? But Gary, I raised him from the dead. And I also will raise Debbie." I tried to argue God out of it, and I didn't know that in just a few days I would hold my wife's hand for the very last time. My wife was in a coma, and my sister-in-law, who was a nurse, put a stethoscope on her heart and told me to talk to her. So I told Debbie, "I love you, I love you, I love you." Debbie's sister told me that the most incredible thing happened. When I told Debbie that I loved her, her heart sped up. When I didn't say anything, her heart slowed down. A few minutes later, Debbie died. The date was April 9th. I buried my best friend. Losing my wife was the most painful experience I've ever had to face. But if the resurrection could help me through her death, Christ's resurrection can get us through anything. Heaven is living eternally with God and your loved ones, the resurrection of Jesus gives us assurance of heaven. We see the scripture. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene. So we come to Mary again, and this is the capstone on a series we've been doing on apologetics. We've started and we've been talking about the proof that God exists, and we've gone all the way through many different apologetic arguments. If you're interested in that, on the back of this card, you can pull up every single sermon that we preached in this series. We went through evolution. We went through all the arguments for God. We went through the arguments for Scripture. And we enter into the final argument. Did Jesus really raise from the dead? I mean, that's it, right? If he rose from the dead, then it's true. If he didn't rise from the dead, then it's not. Right? It all comes to Easter. Is this truth or is it fiction? And it's one or the other. There's not a middle line. We can't live in the middle of these two truths. It's either true or it's not true. And then the answer to that question dictates the rest of our lives. And so the argument would be chiefly that, well, this is just a made-up story, but can I tell you that people that are making up a story, they wouldn't give you as their prime witness in this culture, in this time period, a woman. They wouldn't. I mean, that's nothing to say about our culture in our time period or any women here. But the reality is, in this culture, in this time period, a woman's testimony was worth nothing. And yet John, in writing the story of the resurrection, the most important thing he could write about, the most important topic he could write about, he starts with a woman that gets to the tomb. And then it's very interesting. Think of it for a second. Someone that was constructing a lie then wouldn't use the example that she thought the body was stolen. Would she? If John's mode was to construct a lie, why would he use Mary? And why would he say when she got to the tomb, she thought someone took the body? Wouldn't she construct a better lie than that? But we look at the scripture, right? Now, on the first day of the week, Mary came to the tomb early. It was dark, and she saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one who Jesus loved, and said to them, "Not, he's risen." She didn't go, "It's true. He's alive." She said, "They took his body. They've taken the Lord. And we don't know where they've laid them." See, as you sit here this morning, we have to deal with the arguments against the resurrection, right? So let's talk about them. Why not? One of the chief arguments against the resurrection is that he didn't really die. Somehow it was a swoon theory. They thought he was dead, but he was really not dead. So after insane torture, where his body was torn up from top to bottom on the back by a whip that had bone and metal, to the point where when the Romans whipped someone, they didn't whip someone so that it was actually a game to them. They would have carvings in the ground and they would see which Roman could get the blood to travel down the carvings the further than the other. That's how they did that. So the object of the torture was to see how much blood we could get out of this person's body and how far we could get it to go down the carvings in the ground. After that, they made him carry his cross, and he couldn't even do that. Then they nailed him to a cross, and then these executioners, who were expert executioners, by the way, they knew how to kill people, got to him and said, "He's dead." They stuck a spear up his side, and water and blood flowed out, showing that he was dead. They took his body down, they wrapped it in grave clothes, they carried it to a tomb, they put a stone in front of the tomb, and then guards in front of the stone. And this theory says that after all of that, he somehow woke up inside the tomb, unwrapped himself, unrolled the stone, and left. Does that seem reasonable to you? I mean, when I have the flu, I can barely get out of bed. But yet, a man that's been tortured like that and hung on a cross for hours with a spear shoved up his side, having nails put through his hands and his feet, that it's just, that, to me, that doesn't seem very reasonable. Some people would argue that it was just all a hallucination, that these people were so just distraught that they wanted him to be the Messiah so bad that they just, it was just a mass hallucination. 500 people at one time hallucinated that Jesus had risen from the dead. The disciples hallucinated it. Mary hallucinated it. But the problem with that theory is that it's just not how hallucinations work. Hallucinations are personal. People hallucinate things based on their chemistry and the way they're made up. Mass hallucinations do not happen. The smartest among us that understand brains and chemistry would tell you that's just not plausible, that amount of people would hallucinate the same thing. Some people would say, well, they went to the wrong tomb. They must have gone to the wrong tomb. Now, I know my wife is not good with directions, but I think Mary would make the tomb. I'm just kidding. You can laugh. Gosh. Get an email. She knows I love her. Wrong tomb. Come on. Think about it for a second. Just a little time later, Peter would get up, and in the same town where the tomb was, he would preach the gospel that Jesus had risen from the dead, and thousands of people would believe. If they went to the wrong tomb, why wouldn't everyone go, nope, the tomb's over there? Peter, what are you talking about? You're crazy. You're hallucinating. You're mentally unstable. No, people were giving their lives because the tomb was actually empty. They knew where it was. They knew the stone wasn't there, and they knew it was empty. And it changed the lives of everyone in that city. And the people in that city had to make a decision. Either they believed it or they didn't. And you sitting here today or listening online, you need to make a decision. You either believe it or you don't. Did it happen or didn't it happen? Well, then what they would say is well, they must have stole the body. The disciples stole the body. But listen, even Matthew records that was the first thing that the enemies of Jesus started to tell people to tell everyone. Why would he do that? Look at Matthew. And when they had assembled with the elders and taking counsel, they gave a sufficient sum of money to the soldiers. The soldiers that were in front of the tomb, they gave them a bunch of money. And they said to him, go tell people his disciples came by night and stole away. Look at this. I love this. Stole away the body while we were asleep. Now, what would you say if someone told you, and you were questioning whether the tomb was really empty or not, if someone came to you and said, well, I was outside the tomb, but while I was asleep, the disciples came and stole the body, what would you say? How'd you know it was the disciples if you were asleep? You were all asleep. The whole legion was asleep. And these disciples that were scared for their lives came and rolled the stone away while all of you were sleeping and didn't wake you up and unwrap the body. By the way, why would you unwrap a body that you were going to take? Why would you unwrap it? No one would do that. No one would unwrap a dead body and steal the body. You'd steal the body wrapped. But the theories just, they don't make sense, and we must consider the evidence. It's actually more reasonable. We've been saying this the whole series on apologetics. It's more reasonable to believe that the tomb was empty and Jesus rose from the dead than not. It's actually more reasonable. So let's go on. Because Peter, look at, I love this because I'm just curious which one's short and fat, because I would probably be the one left behind in the race to the tomb. So Peter went out with the other disciple. Some of you just totally didn't get that, but you will when we get there. So Peter So Peter went out with the other disciples, and they were going towards the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. Now look at what goes on in verse 5. He stoops to look in. He sees the linen clothes lying there, but he doesn't go in. So he stays outside the tomb. Then Peter comes rushing in, following him, and goes into the tomb. Peter runs into the tomb. He sees the linen clothes lying there. He sees the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not laying with the linen clothes, but folded up in the place by itself. And what you see going on here is, so Mary gets to the tomb. The tomb's empty. She's like, whoa, someone stole the body. She just goes and gets to the disciples. The disciples get there, and they start to examine what's going on. And like I said in the beginning, this is the capstone message to a series on apologetics that we've been doing. And so I offer you the evidence, because this all started, this whole series started, at least in my mind, when we preached a message on Peter and Jesus walking on water. And we said, people just don't walk on water. That doesn't happen. This is the book we believe in. A book that tells us that someone walks on water. I've never seen anyone walk on water, have you? And yet, I'm reading a book, and I'm basing my life on a book that has a story about people walking on water. Or I'm reading a book, and I'm basing my life on a story about a person that is crucified and dies and is risen from the dead. And people don't come back to life after they die. But we started this whole series with the fact that there's two different worldviews out there. And yes, you're correct. If you're in a naturalistic worldview, if you're in a materialistic worldview, if you're in a worldview that promotes evolution, if you're in a worldview that says you can't know the spiritual, yes, then this is crazy. But if you're in a worldview that isn't a closed system, that acknowledges that the system that is here is contingent, that in order to have a contingent system, there must be something that's not contingent, then this is, frankly, very plausible. What do I mean by that? Well, and I said this before, have any of you been driving down the road and had to swerve out of the way because something popped into existence? No. Have any of you ever been sitting at your dinner table with your children and miraculously something appeared on your dinner table? No. Why? Because things don't pop out of nothing. And the world, it didn't pop out of nothing. It doesn't happen. It never happens. And everything that we have, from the chairs to the stage, to you, to your kids, it happens because something caused it to happen. You were born because something caused that transition to happen where life was produced. Every effect has a cause. That's what you need to understand. Every effect has a cause. Everything has a cause. And in a closed system, that goes into absurdity. What do I mean by that? If everything has a cause and you're in a closed system and there can be nothing outside of it, then you're in absurdity. It's called an infinite regress. You keep saying, well, that had a cause and that had a cause and that had a cause and that had a cause, into absurdity. For a system to exist that necessitates a cause, there has to be something that's uncaused to cause it to happen. It is human logic. You can't escape it. As you sit here today and you doubt the existence of God, you cannot escape the fact that there necessarily has to be one that exists that's always existed. Whether you want to call it the God I'm preaching about or not, you have to accept the existence of that being. And we talked about that, and we said it's more reasonable to believe that there's a God than that there's not a God. Well, I didn't prove that it's the God of the Bible. You're right. But what I did prove is that everything we have, we get from him, and we have love and we have relationship. So then we talked about the Trinity and the fact that God has to be in three persons because we experience love and relationship. And God has that being, it has to be personal because we're personal. If it was just a power, if it was just this cosmic energy, there would be no personality. There would be no consciousness. There would be no love. There would be no relationship. And then we got to the idea of evolution, that we all evolved out of a single cell organism. It makes no sense. How come it doesn't make any sense? Because we've never seen it happen in the history of the world. You can never point it out. You can't point out that ever happening. And in addition to that, it's not in the fossil record. That our world doesn't show that that's even a possibility, that something would evolve from nothing. It's way more reasonable to believe that a God created you with purpose than to think you're a purposeless pile of cells. And then we come to the capstone. If this is true, if God exists and God is a God of love and God created us for relationship, then what must be true? He communicates to us, right? If it's all true, then we would think that this God would communicate. And we talked about the fact that Scripture, this book, has been proven to be historical. Without a shadow of a doubt, Caesar himself has only 54 possible sources that you could get his story, and no one would question the existence of Caesar. The Gospels have 79,000 sources, 5,800 Greek sources, 24,000 Latin sources, 50,000 fragments, written decades from the events. There's nothing in history that's more certain than the events of this book. And if that's true, then you sitting here today, you need to deal with the facts. And the facts are, was there an empty tomb? See, and here's the reality of the whole thing. I can't argue you there. I'll never be able to argue you there. Sorry, I'm messing around with this. I can't get it where I want it. But look at what it says in verse 8. Then the other disciple who had reached the tomb first, he went in. And look at what it says here. He saw and he believed. I want you to see two things. First, he saw and he believed. See, I can't argue you there. You can poke holes in everything I just said. And the reality of it is that none of us were saved because someone argued us to faith. We were saved because the Spirit of God came in and he transformed our heart. And he opened our eyes and he unplugged our ears and he gave us the gift of faith. And because of the miraculous grace of Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit, you're saved here. Not because someone stood up on a stage and argued you into salvation. I'll never be able to do it, but they saw and they believed. And I'm telling you right now, some of you are sitting here and the Spirit of God is poking at your heart and he's poking at your mind and he's telling you, you have to deal with this evidence. You have to deal with it today. You have to deal with it before you leave this room. You have to make a decision. Do you believe this is real or do you not believe this is real? And here's the thing. I love this. They believed, but they didn't really understand it. See, you don't have to be a theologian. You don't have to be an expert on the Trinity. You don't have to understand the intricacies of the different books of the Bible and the languages that it's written in. These guys, they believed and they didn't understand it. I don't understand why I believe, but I know this is true. And some of you are sitting here today and you're saying, I just feel it. I know it in my heart. I know this is true. You can sense it in your heart. You can feel it in your mind. You've been denying it all your life, but you know it's true. And here's why you know it's true. Because like the video that we saw, he changes lives. and you're looking at people here and you know people that know Jesus and he's radically changed their lives, and you know that the world says people don't change, and they don't. People don't change in and of himself, but Jesus changes people, doesn't he? People that were lost in fear and anxiety and drug addiction and anger, God's radically changed their lives. You saw the video. Or how about a guy like Dr. Habermas, who stands at his wife's bedside as she's dying and has hope? How about that? How do you have hope in the face of death if this is all just a lie? If this is a lie, if this isn't true, if the worldview is correct and we are just a product of evolution and God doesn't exist, then there is no hope. When you die, it's done. It's darkness. There's nothing. It's nothingness. We came from nothingness and you are going to nothingness, and there is no hope. But if this is true, then there's all the hope in the world. There's all the hope in the world that this is not the end. That there's more to life than this existence. And that you, when you die, you will pass from this existence into glorious paradise with Jesus Christ. I'll close with this. Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white standing where the body of Jesus had lain. One at the head and one at the feet. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They've taken away my Lord, and I don't know where they have laid him." Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him, "Rabboni." Can I tell you right now, Jesus is here. Amen. And he's calling some of your names right now. You don't think he's there. You don't feel him. You wonder if you've just gone too far away. But he's calling your name. And here's the reality. If Jesus rose from the dead, his message was true. He's God. He is the way. He is the life. He is the light. And through faith in him, we can have life and light. You no longer have to live in darkness and fear. If Jesus rose from the dead, death is not the end for us. If Jesus rose from the dead, death is not the end for our loved ones. If Jesus rose from the dead, death is defeated. We can have hope. Jesus rose from the dead. The tomb is empty. And by faith in him, you can have life eternal. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for your grace. We ask that you would seal this in the hearts and the minds of people this morning. We thank you that the tomb is empty. We thank you that we could celebrate your resurrection. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Church, stand with us as we continue to worship.
Without knowing, oh, but God, oh, but God, it's you.
Well, we just want to thank you for spending your Easter morning with us. Just a reminder, next Sunday, times are back to normal, 9 and 11. I just want to ask if you're here today and this made sense to you, or God's poking at your heart, or you feel the pull of the Holy Spirit, don't walk away. Talk to someone. There's people up here that will talk to you. We have pastors up here. We have people in the lobby. Any of these singers or band people, they're up here to serve, and they would be willing to talk to you. I just don't leave today if you feel like you want to respond to the gospel and know Jesus as your Savior. Let me just pray for you, and I'll let you go. Lord, I just thank you for everyone here. We pray that you would give them a special blessing this day as they go to be with their families. We ask for your grace and your mercy. We thank you for your sacrifice, and we rejoice in the empty tomb. In Jesus' name, amen. You're dismissed.